unknown.
You again, you like sir, but call me Rahul, call me Anna, call me.
Sorry, Anna.
Be comfortable.
I used to call my professor.
Yeah, but
so it's a habit in college.
But I want you to be comfortable.
Okay, Anna.
I want you to relax.
I'll stick to Anna. No more, sir. Yeah. Okay. So my question is, even now you shared your pain by the loss of your father. So your
loss of my father, no, because I still carry my father with me. So, look, understand something. Violence cannot take away anything from you. At all. It does not have the power. You can give up something, but violence cannot take anything from you. My father's alive in me. And by the way, a lot of the things that you have heard today, they came to me from my father. So my father is talking through me. So it's not that my father is not there today.
After many hardships that your family have faced in politics, that is your grandmother, your father, what made you to step back in politics? What gave you the courage to be in politics even after all the hardships you and your family have faced?
See, politics is a lens through which you see me. You see me right now, you're like, oh, he's a politician. But that's just, it's a very small lens. I am a human being, right? As you saw, I'm a cook, right? I can cook. I do many, many different things. But you've been told that I am a politician, and that's the lens with which you see me, right? It's only one of the things that make me. For me, whatever I do, I believe in certain ideas. Okay? Like for example, when she told me that she's not going to be an engineer, this caused me disturbance. I didn't like it. Right? I was, why is society not letting her dream? Why is society destroying her dream? So, when I see somebody being treated unfairly, I don't like it. It irritates me and I want to try and do something about it. And I found that this profession that you call politics allows me to do that for many people. And so I do that. I don't think it requires courage. I just go ahead and do it. You know, that's just what I do. And for me, like this conversation I had with you, I'm going away with a lot of understanding that I got from you. You will think that, oh, I came here, gave a speech and left. But I learned from you. I learned many things from you. And I'm going to take that home with me. And I hope that you learned one or two things from me. Yeah. So I think that's what life is about. It's about me respecting you, me listening to you, and then you doing the same, and then us improving both our situation. I don't think that needs courage. No?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Okay, now, okay, last one.
Hello, sir.
Now, I'm going to get into trouble. Because I've got other people in a public meeting.
I'm here.
Hello,
sir. I'm here.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Anna, first of all, very thank you for spending your precious time with us. And my question is that whenever you thought that, why most of these women...
Can you hold it closer so everyone hears?
Sir? Okay, sir.
Yeah. Louder.
Because they can't.
Thanks a lot, sir. Whenever you think about that, most of the women were the toppers in the schools and schools exam and college exam, but only few were the can reach the higher states in their as compared to men. Only few can reach their toppers. For example, CEO of Google is a man. CEO of Tesla is also a man. Most of the politicians were also men, and most of the scientists who received Nobel Prize are also men. Though we got 50-50 equal rights from the government, whether really a women empowerment exists in India, and whenever you thought about that?
Well, see, there is a door in front of you, right? It is quite clear that it is unfair. You have to break the door. We have to open the door. So you have to make examples.
Okay, definitely, right? Anna.
So you and many other girls here have to become examples. You have to try and become the best at what you do.
Really?
Right? Yeah. And I'm pretty confident that with 5 or 6 good examples, you will have a line of young ladies behind you saying, if she can do it, then I'm also going to do it.
Yeah.
No?
Yes.
And so that should be the spirit. It is unfair, but we are going to make it fair. There is a door in front of you. We're going to break the door down. Okay?
Yes,
okay. Thank you.
Anna.
Girls, I know you all hate letting him go, but we'll have to let him go now because he has another his program to attend.
Unfortunately, look, it's been a pleasure for me coming here and talking to you. Did you have a nice time? It's been a pleasure for me.
So I have 2 questions for you. The first one
political?
Is...
Political ones or non-political?
One is little bit of a political one, okay. But not much of a political one, actually. So the first question...
I'm fine with both.
Okay. Okay.
They might not like it.
Okay. Okay. The first one is unemployment is being a major issue in India, as we all know. But what would you do to reduce or remove unemployment of women when you become the Prime Minister of India?
I think... As I said, I'll explain it very simply. If you want to create jobs, the most important thing is the banking system, right? The money that the country has in the banks and who controls it. That's the most important thing. Today, largest number of jobs in India are produced by small and medium businesses, entrepreneurs. But they do not have access to the banks. The banks, majority of the money of the banks is given to 5, 10, 15 of the biggest businessmen in the country. I would move the money of the banks from the 5-10 biggest businesses in the country to the millions of smaller and middle-sized businesses in the country. That's what I would do. And then I would ensure that millions of Indian women who want to start a business, who want to employ people for India, can easily take bank loans and start their business. That's the first thing. Second thing is, I feel that the understanding of finance, understanding of money, women are not taught about money. Society doesn't like teaching women about money. Because the moment women understand money, women can become independent. And so I think that's a very important thing to do, to show women the link between finance and independence. There's a direct link between finance and independence. If you get married to somebody, and you do not have access to finance, you cannot be independent. Simple. So
educating women about how money works, what it means to be financially literate, what it means to be financially independent. These are very, very important things. And I think I would emphasize on that. I would tell all of you that one of the most important goals for you should be financial independence. 100% financial independence. You should be able to earn your own money. You should be able to spend your own money. And you should be independent as a result of that. So I think those are the things I would focus on.
Okay, sir.
You've all gone quiet. Do you agree with that?
Yes, sir.
You agree with that? How many of you here are financially independent? Look at that. How many of you here are financially independent? Is anyone here financially independent? So that's an important step for you. You should think about your own financial independence. And I would like that when I meet you 3 or 4 years from today, and I come to this room and I say, listen, how many of my sisters are financially independent? At least 90% of you should say, yeah, I'm financially independent.